Boom, gotta lower the lights, right? The Central State, no, not Central State, Springfield YMCA. We had gone over there to be introduced by a very close personal friend, Debbie, so that I would be, because my wife just needed an escort.
Because I was a good girl. And I didn't have any boyfriends because I was a good girl and I was still in high school. So she knew this guy who was very well known around town that was available as a professional.
Debutante ball dancer. Escort, what they call it. Yeah.
He escorted me all right.
And the room was really dark. Hey, guys, you know, boom, you know, get you one. And the room was very dark. It was the YMCA, and they had, I think they had a little dancing thing, something going on. And I remember looking way back in the corner, and did you have that green coat, that same green coat? You were, okay, so
I
here she comes.
A green dress, actually.
Yeah, okay, so here she come across the floor, and the first thing that captured me more than anything else at all was the beautiful brightness of her eyes.
Guys, don't believe that. He wasn't looking in my eyes.
Now, wait a minute, babe. This is supposed to be
sophisticated. That's all right. It's the truth. I found out the truth. You kept telling me my eyes. I never.
Springfield YMCA. Back in 1970. A date like that.
People can do math.
Calculate, yeah. Wow.
Okay, we were, let's see, I think we knew each other for a year, then we got engaged for 11 months.
Right.
He proposed to me in my grandmother's basement.
Yeah.
Still, he was fresh.
Why? What was fresh about that?
Because that was a really serious kiss.
He
proposed to me in my grandmother's basement because, you know, back those days, people had their basements fixed up and stuff, you know. So I remember we had a fireplace down there and, you know, the living room thing. And he proposed to me there. And then I made him ask my grandfather for my hand.
And ain't nothing wrong with that today, but we'll move on.
That was part of the requirement.
Yeah.
So he asked my grandparents for my hand in marriage. They were very acceptable, but of course, when he had to go to my mother.
Oh, hey, I think I've said this sometime or so in a sermon or something, but I did go ahead to go see her. And up to that time, I was like, you know, the dude. I was like shirt tail in all the time, drive the car, always brought her back on time. Even during that time, I had to fake bringing her back because I brought her back a little late. And we were about like 2-3 miles from the house. So I got out the car.
This is out in the country.
In the country.
Really?
I got out the car and rubbed my hands on some grease under the hood.
That should have been a big red flag that this guy knew what to do to lie to my grandparents. That should have been a big red flag because I wonder, what is he doing out there?
So I got back in. So our explanation, our car broke down, and I'm just so sorry I'm late. And Mr. Riggins, this will never happen again. As a matter of fact, the grandmother came out first and sat down at the table and made her grandfather get up and come and sit at the table to get this explanation and all of that, but it worked. But those were great days, and we really enjoyed them, and it was a time of a kind of slower, less pressure kind of times than they are that we live in now. But it was an amazing time.
No, it wasn't. You were pressurizing me all the time, you know?
Me?
Okay, these people think it was so simple. No,
pressure?
Say, yeah. Professional guy and me country naive, please.
Oh. So hey, tip number two, go to the country. Well, I know the marriage day was, everybody ran away from the house. Oh, not ran away. Everybody went to the wedding location. It was back at the Y again. No, it was at the church, Church of God Church. And everybody left her at the house. And we all sitting over there looking at watches and carrying on. And I thought she changed her mind. Really, I did.
And I didn't worry about it because my prayer had been, Lord, you know, if this guy's not for me, whatever it takes, just don't let this happen. So I was like, okay, this is a sign.
That's why you all can't always go by no sign. You know?
So I wasn't worried, you know, finally somebody came back and got me, you know, let wedding start a little bit late. Okay, so when we got married, he was a deacon, which was one of the things, the good green flags. You know, he went to church.
Halo?
He liked going to church. Yeah. I went to church, but I didn't like going to church. So, I mean, I felt like he was really good, a good guy. So, but I had no clue. And, you know, like, we're from the Holiness Church, and he was Baptist, so I figured he really wasn't even saved. Okay. Because that's the way we felt. Only our people were saved. So I was like, okay, but he's still a good guy. So, but he loved to go to church, and he was a junior deacon, which I'm like, oh, okay, what is that? And he always had this, he had an affinity for the things of God. It wasn't clear. It was getting to be more obvious that he was more serious than a deacon. And, you know, different people, older people were good at saying, oh, he's going to be a preacher. But then, you know, to me, older people always said, any man who loves the Lord is going to preach. You know, so I didn't take that real seriously. But then it got more clear. And then I know Shauna was 6 weeks old.
Right.
And we were driving to Florida to pick up my sister.
Yeah.
For my mother, that's when we had our brand new 1967
Dodge Charger,
you know,
white top,
brand emerald, new, spanking
emerald,
new.
Not just green, emerald green. Yeah, one of them got,
So we were driving all the way to Miami, Florida, Miami from Ohio. He almost ran off the road, but he woke me up and said, get the Bible out of the glove compartment and read me this scripture. So I'm reading the scripture. And he says that's when he felt called to the ministry. Okay, so, well, you know, for me, the scripture was somewhere out in the distance. Like, how did you get that out of that? But it was like, okay, you know. And so that's when I found out that he was serious about being called to the ministry.
Part of being this junior deacon person, they had an assignment. We had to go to some lady, shut-in lady's house and to take some communion or maybe go pray. But when we knocked on the door, and she opened the door, and I said, hello, my name is Stanley Scott. And as soon as I said that, she just broke out in tears, and she was just wailing and going, she said, oh, look at you, the hand of God is on your life. You're going to do great things for God, and you're such a wonderful young man. And I'd never seen a lady before. And so from that moment, that grip on my heart got to be there. And then it seemed like I'll call this, the pressure to preach just got on me. And it was a wonderful time. And from then on, we've been out there.
Says we, I didn't get that.
Will you be serious at all?
I am serious.
Come out.
No. I am serious.
It was a kind of experience, and it encompassed so many things that impacted our lives, and that impact, that hand of God has truly sustained us over all of these decades, and we still love the Lord and love His cause and love His people. Now tell me you don't. Tell me you don't.
I know he can cut this part out. Okay, so if you put in some education, you know, following God, we had some babies.
Oh, let me tell you this. She told me, y'all, that if I was going to preach, she wasn't going to be married to no jackleg preacher. So she said, you got to go get yourself some education. if you're going to be my husband and going to be preaching.
Because, you know, being Baptist, you got to get saved. And I wanted him saved, so, you know, had to go through that process. And then when he, I think we just had our fourth child, right about the time we got ready to start Salvation Temple. And for me, it was like, oh my God, I never want to, when we left the Baptist church, like, thank you, Jesus. Because the deacons ran the church and was just full of strife, So I was happy to be out of that, truly happy, never regretted. And the good thing about when you're trying to follow God, it's like all the transitions, you don't look back with regrets. And this, the one thing that I can say that for Stanley, whenever he would tell me, I believe God is saying to do this, or believe, I believe God wants me. When he would say that, for me, the onus was on him and God, the responsibility. So I could take my little babies, pack up, move to Detroit, which at the time was the murder capital of the world.
And not only was it the murder capital at that time, but when we first got here, I think that was one of those winters that they talked about where in the 70s, we moved here August the 26th, 1975 is when we moved up. And that was one of those years, or two or three of those years, where snow was sky high and it was super cold and all of this kind of thing. And God helped us, I'll say transition, and maybe I mean more that he helped us be able to adjust to our environments. When I saw Raymond Cantrell walk into the bank, I kind of scrunched down in the cubicle with Mildred Morgan at the time. I kind of scrunched down in there because I didn't want to see him. I didn't have to explain nothing. But he walked over to the cubicle and leaned over the cubicle and looked at, hey, I've been looking for you. And from there, he offered us to be able to come and hold our services in their brand new renovated chapel. Said he wouldn't charge us any money. He would do everything they can to help us be able to go forward and develop. And we met there for almost 2 years. No, 12 months. I think it was 12 months or something like that. Yeah, there were some times when we had to push a casket or two out of the way, or hurry up. And we did our children's church back in the back. They had to walk by some casket. Sometimes people laying up in the casket. But hey, you got to do what you got to do.
Salvation Temple got to going good, uh-huh. Now on the boulevard, then he comes in and says, I believe God wants me to go submit myself to Bishop Butler, or it was Pastor Butler, and I'm like, are you kidding me? And I even told Bishop Pastor Butler at the time, mm-hmm. I said, my husband is a preacher, and you all teach, mm-hmm. So how's that going to work? And he says, well, you know, that's what we need. And basically, our relationship there was very good.
Oh yeah,
even until the end. It you have your little, you know, whatever.
People who do their stuff, but.
But basically, it was good.
And look where he took us. Boom, halfway around the world. I mean, I spent probably 7 or more years in a phase of international travel.
To get when we moved out of the country, you know, I cried. You know, I was just like,
y'all should have seen her. This woman out at the airport, she was crying, and the grandbabies are like, and our daughter had told the kids that Nana and Papa are going up to heaven.
Going up in the sky.
Going up in the sky, and they probably won't be back.
They won't be back for a long time.
For a long, and the kids are, and so everybody crying and carrying them, and she, here she is, she's taking money, and she's passing my, here, man, take this because we can't use it. I said, girl, you better keep, we won't be able to use it over there. So here, you take this big chunk. I said, give me that money. And she cried so long, so hard. And this was her first international flight, not first flight. Okay.
To London.
And we went, and we were on the plane. Her eyes all puffy, and she leaning on, and the hostess walked up, and she's kind of like, well, did he do something to you?
You know, know, renting those buildings was easy. It's fine.
We back can make when we
the,
were
they do the cleaning. They structure. Do. We're making the payments easy. Let's just go with the flow. Everything is good. Oh no, we gotta have our own building. Oh no, blah blah blah. And so then, thus, you know, we come up with this building, and then who ends up doing, you know, coming.
Cleaning.
And then the gotta go to court. Go to court? Who's got money to go to court? And do you know how old you are? You know, this is my time to relax. You know, I got to make up time for when I was gone. And here you go again. It's like, Lord, you brought me to the murder capital. This man has gone to Africa. He gone to India. And enough is enough, don't you think? And it's like I had met the point of no return. I couldn't leave him. You know, I was getting ready to get his retirement money. If he died, get his insurance money. And so it's just, I got to stay here. Now I got to go through another one.
Tip number four, keep you a good insurance policy. Got to hold her. It's cheaper to keep her.
And so I try, since I'm happy with who I am, I try to bless my husband. It's hard. It's really hard to bless this man. You know, he can be so difficult to deal with. But then on the other hand, he makes me laugh. You know, on the other hand, he gives me money. You know, on the other hand, you know, I can travel different places with somebody, you know?
Thousands of people, more than we could ever imagine, and those that will meet us in heaven will be able to say that because God allowed us to tell them that he so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him will not, shall not perish, but have everlasting life. We believe that. We offer and recommend that to you. And we say that God has proven himself time, over and over again. And we are fully confident that every step that we take, even from this moment on, will be guided by the hand of God, supplied by the hand of God, resourced by the hand of God, and that thing that he sends his word to will be accomplished in the thing whereunto he sent it. So thank you all so very much for sharing this great celebration with us. We honor you, we bless you, we thank God for you and what you have, the part you've played in our lives. Many of you really fed us, or some of your family members fed us when we were in our very lean years and lean times. You hung in there with us. You held up our arms. Many of you challenged us to even continue to go forward because we believe that you believe that God's hand is on our lives. So thank you so very much. We cannot say thank you enough, but we will continue to live our lives in such a way that you'll always know that we believe God in Jesus' name.